Tom.
Wait, we're recording.
Oh, right, okay, good. Welcome to Tech of the Week, Trusted Reviews weekly tech talk show where we talk about all the tech we've seen this week. I'm Thomas Newton, computing editor, and with me I have Max Parker, mobile editor. So Max, you were out in Paris last week for the launch of the new Huawei P30 series.
I was indeed in lovely Paris.
Oui, Paris.
Yeah, that's about as much French as I know. Yeah, I mean, it was a massive event. I think they said they had like 3,000 people there.
Okay.
In this kind of convention center in the middle of Paris. And yeah, that was all for the launch of the Huawei P30 and the Huawei P30 Pro. So I've been using the P30 Pro since that day.
And this what
this lovely glistening, lovely, shiny.
Yeah.
And yeah, I mean, it's a fantastic phone, which has kind of become predictable for Huawei now. Last year, the P20 Pro was our favorite phone of the year. And yeah, again, you know, the P30 Pro is a really good phone that's coming out at the same time as the Galaxy S10. So these two phones going head to head. And in other years, maybe, you know, 5 years ago, you'd think Samsung would have been so dominant. But Huawei has just come so far. And
they seem to have come in from like an inside track and they've stolen a lot of thunder.
Yeah, and they seem like they're one of the few smartphone brands that is really trying to do stuff differently and trying to push things forward.
Right.
You've kind of got, especially like Apple and Google play it very safe every year. The iPhone XS last year, the Google Pixel 3 were kind of marginal improvements on already good phones.
But they weren't tearing up the rule book in a big way.
Whereas,
like, they had the triple lens camera setup with the P20 Pro last year, right?
Yeah, and then the Pixel 3 had one sensor.
Right,
and
okay.
The iPhone just had its kind of regular two. But again, with the P30 Pro, Huawei feels like it's just taking things that other step forward, mainly in photography, which we'll get to.
Okay.
But this really feels like, I think it's the best smartphone camera that I've ever used.
Wow, okay. That's a bold claim. Why do you think it's the best you've ever used?
So there's three main cameras on the back. You've got a main 40 megapixel sensor with an f1.6 aperture. You've got a 20 megapixel ultra wide sensor, so really good for kind of landscape shots, really good for kind of getting all that city view in. And then finally, there is an 8 megapixel zoom lens, so a telephoto lens. And this is kind of the lens that's really different and really unique. So it uses this kind of periscope design. So if you can actually see inside the camera, there's this kind of periscope design that
is this where it's using a mirror essentially have. You kind of essentially have an optical zoom sensor in here, but instead of it coming straight out of the phone, it's at like 90 degrees.
Yes. So Huawei say that you get 5 times optical zoom.
Right. Okay.
Which is, I mean, that normally some phones like the iPhone,
you'll get
2x.
Okay.
This has 5x optical zoom, and the pictures that produces, I'm sure we'll put some on the screen now, look tremendous. They look really good. They're like you're taking it really close up or with a proper camera.
So there's no loss of definition, there's no.
No, they look really
sort of
good.
Blurring at the edges.
Yeah, we gave the phone to our camera editor and he's been shooting with it all week as well. And yeah, he agrees that the zoom from this phone isn't like zoom from a phone.
Wow, okay.
And so
they've done something really special here.
They have, yes. So that's 5x. You can go up to 10x, which is what they call hybrid zoom.
Right, okay. So this is where it's a blend of optical and software.
Yes.
Okay.
So Huawei say it's lossless, you shouldn't lose any definition.
At 10 times?
At 10 times, yeah.
Right.
So you're taking some of those 40 megapixels from the main camera.
Yeah.
Taking them down, using them with the telephoto lens to kind of amalgamate an image together.
You can't take a 40 megapixel still photo at 10 times.
No.
Right, so this is where the sensors working together
kind
of comes into its own. So it's, that's a really clever system.
Yeah, and you can even push it up to 50 times zoom.
Okay.
And again, that's more of a headline feature now. That's 50 times zoom. It doesn't look great, and it's really hard to like steady.
Yeah.
But again, you can do it, and it still looks better than other phones that have done that.
Right.
But I think just having, what makes this camera so special for me and why I would want to continue using it is the versatility that the three lenses offer. Fantastic shots from the main 40 megapixel sensor. So it takes that 40 megapixel shot, turns each pixel into 4 and gives you a 10 megapixel main image. So you're not kind of stuffing the phone up with loads of 40 megapixel
massive
images.
Files. Right, yeah.
And They look really good. There's loads of AI machine learning stuff built into the camera app. Obviously, they partnered with Leica again. So you've got this Leica camera app with AI, and it can pick out kind of scenery and stuff.
So it's got Leica lenses?
Yes.
Right.
Yeah. But loads of phones can take good daylight photos. You know, that's not really the challenge anymore.
Yeah.
It's low light.
But it's exceptionally good on this phone.
Yeah, it's really good. But it really is low light.
Yeah.
So this phone has a night mode, like the Pixel has a night mode, and that takes a number of shots over I think it goes from either a 6 to a 12 second period.
Okay.
It will take loads of shots at multiple exposures, some really bright, some really dark, and it will combine those photos together to make this night shot. And I'm not completely convinced by this whole night shot thing. It can take really good low light shots. If you're in a completely dark room with no lights on at all,
okay,
this phone will pick out better than your eye can see, and it will brighten up to
That's
levels
kind of
that.
Scary.
Yeah, it will brighten up to levels that aren't realistic.
Right, so that's better than human vision.
Better than human
vision. It's got artificial intelligence baked into it. How scared of this should
you
be?
Saying that P30 is going to take over.
Well, you heard it here first. You know, I for one welcome our robot overlords.
So yeah, I mean, the low light stuff is really good. The night mode suffers when there are light portions in the picture.
Okay.
So if you have kind of a few blobs of light or someone moving,
the sensor can't handle it.
It's not as good. But okay. Then I sometimes prefer the pictures just from the main camera without the night mode on at night, because it's got a wide aperture, loads of light can come in, and yeah, they look really good too. But yeah, it's a fun camera to use because you've got that wide, you've got that zoomed in, you've got that normal. You can take all these different photos in all these different situations, and they all look really good. And it just makes you want to be more creative because you've got all the, it's like having a whole lens bag jammed onto the back of your phone.
That's a nice way of putting it. I hadn't thought about it like that before, but I think you're right. It is having a really, really big toolkit in your pocket.
Yeah. And then the final, Huawei calls it their fourth camera. It's more of a sensor. So it's a TOF sensor. So a time of flight.
Time of flight. Yeah. I've heard TOF talked about this year a lot. It was a bit of a thing at MWC.
Yeah, it was a bit of a thing at MWC. So Honor, which is a kind of part of Huawei.
It's Huawei's little sister brand, sibling brand.
On their View 20, on the back, on the camera. LG actually used it on the front of the G8 for hand movement.
Is this for the gesture-powered thing on the G8?
Yeah.
Which I wasn't entirely convinced about.
No, but maybe when we try it, it'll be good. Okay. So basically the TOF sensor is a 3D sensor. It can detect depth. And Huawei uses it here to improve the bokeh shots. So it's got portrait mode where you can add that kind of silky blur on the back of someone's photo. Yep. And again, what the TOF sensor adds is much better at cutting out around kind of intricate details.
Okay.
So previously on other phones, they'd struggle around beards or they'd struggle around glasses. Okay. So you'd be a perfect example, might cut off a bit of your beard. This is a lot more accurate.
We should try it out.
Cutting out around glasses and beards, and you know, the bokeh effect is nice and smooth. And
yeah,
it's good.
This is that fuzzy, soft, out-of-focus effect you get on the edge of the things that you want to be the subject of your photo.
It still looks kind of artificial. All phones do. I think they're always going to. But this is another step forward from other things we've seen. And you've got all these things jammed into this, you know, really good-looking, very fingerprinty phone.
Well, this is the thing. It's a very, very fetching looking device, but like all shiny phones, it tends to... I can see you've got a lot of fingerprint marks on there.
Yeah, already, and I did wipe this before we started filming. But yeah, I mean, it's not just all about the camera. So the camera's obviously
a big
very important, and it's very important. If I was buying a phone, I don't know what you think of it.
I think the ability to take really good pictures and video is a fairly key concern for me. I'm going to be spending a lot of money on something, I want the photos to look as fantastic as they possibly can.
Yeah, so this has kind of other nice bits too. Massive battery. Battery life's really good.
Right.
So 4,200 mAh.
That's pretty big.
It's not only big, but the way that it's optimized is really good. I can get pretty much 2 days, 6 to 7 hour screen on time. I was trying to kill it by streaming Netflix, and it went through the entire series of the OA.
Wow.
Without dying.
Okay.
Playing in HDR with full brightness.
Okay.
So like for media streaming and stuff, the battery's fantastic.
That's pretty amazing.
And you also get one of Huawei's superchargers in the box.
This is their fast charging proprietary technology, right?
Loads of people claim they fast charge phones, but this charged So it charged to 70% in 38 minutes.
Wow, from flat.
From flat, wow. From completely dead. Switched it on,
okay.
Plugged it in. 30 minutes later, it was at 70%. And then it got to 100% in like 57 minutes.
How does that compare generally? Is that acceptable?
For the battery this size,
it's over 4,000 milliamps.
It's very good. I mean, something like the iPhone XS takes about 3 hours to charge. So Apple uses gives you a 5-watt plug in the box of an iPhone. This has a 40-watt plug.
Okay.
So that difference is obviously massive. And I mean, just being able to charge it up so quickly kind of takes away any battery anxiety that you'd have with it.
So you can comfortably go to work, forget to charge it up, and then it's like, oh, it doesn't matter. Yeah, like, the battery's really good. I don't have to charge it.
Forget to charge it overnight. You've got
no big deal.
30 minutes in the morning before you get to work, plug it in, you know, you've got enough battery easily for the day.
It feels like we finally arrived at a time where that's increasingly becoming the norm, where, you know, whereas even a couple of years ago, you would look at your battery and think, oh God, I suppose I better put it on charge.
Yeah.
You'd desperately be looking for like a spare main socket somewhere. But that's not the case now.
No, I've not felt this at all with this phone.
Amazing.
I don't worry about charging it at night. I just plug it in the morning or when I've got a spare 40 minutes near a charger. And you do have to use wireless chargers to get those speeds.
Right, okay.
But even using a regular USB-C, fairly decent wattage brick, it is still fairly quick, 2 hours or so.
Okay.
And wireless charging as well, you know, it's pretty feature packed. It's got an in-display fingerprint sensor in the screen, which is okay. It's just kind of as good as they are at the minute. They're still a bit kind of...
So Huawei's fingerprint scanners have generally been pretty good. So
yeah,
and so you're not as impressed with the. I mean, it is very cool to be able to have it built into the screen.
I wouldn't say it's faster than their old sensors that sat on the back of the phones. It was definitely faster than the one they use in the Mate 20 Pro.
Okay.
Which was very finicky and very unreliable, and just never worked when you wanted it to. This one does work reliably. There's also face unlock if you don't want to use.
If you don't want
to
know,
you can use the 32 megapixel sensor on the front to kind of unlock it by your face. And yeah, I mean, it's a very nice phone that has a very nice screen, very nice design, kind of really thin bezel around the side.
I'm getting the sense that you think it's very nice.
There are some things I don't like about it. I really dislike Huawei software.
Okay.
I think you have to use it for a really long period of time before it becomes...
You get used to it. Is this the EMUI software they've got here?
So this is EMUI 9 on top of Android 9.
Okay.
And
how does that compare to stock Android? Because I've used Huawei phones before and I don't think they're hugely different to stock Android, but maybe I'm wrong here.
I think that it feels like Huawei's aiming these phones at old iPhone users. It's a very iPhone-based UI. You've got these kind of big square icons. You've not got an app tray. Things like the share sheet look very similar to iOS.
Okay.
And kind of if you're used to other Android phones, I find the change is quite drastic.
Okay.
Whereas iPhone users might feel slightly more at home. And it's just the way that Huawei does things. I find that sometimes when you play music apps in the background, they crash a lot more than they do on other phones.
Okay.
And it's just the little bits. It's not as visually appealing either as kind of some of the other UIs. But really, use it for a few weeks, and I think that kind of
and you would
kind
get of used to its
away.
Particular way of doing things.
Yeah.
Okay.
But yeah, I mean, it's so this is the P30 Pro. There's also the P30.
Yeah. So how do those two compare?
So the P30 loses the IP68 water resistance.
Okay.
It loses wireless charging, and it loses that really fast charging as well.
Is the camera more or less the same?
The camera's kind of similar. It doesn't have the periscope element. So its optical zoom goes just to 3x, basically the same as the P20 Pro from last year. Slightly smaller battery. It doesn't have the curved edges on the screen.
Okay.
So there are...
There are
some compromises, but that's £699. This is £899.
Right,
so
okay.
It's quite kind of a big price difference.
Yeah.
Huawei kind of, many years ago, used to be known for kind of producing flagship phones at slightly more affordable prices. Definitely not doing
not
that
anymore.
Now it's kind of balls out, kind of right in there.
We're a premium phone maker.
Yeah,
though.
You know,
right,
they want to be seen as charging the same as Apple charges for the iPhone and Samsung charges for the Note series.
I mean, where we are with iPhone and Galaxy series phone prices now, that's still a little bit less.
It's same price as the S10 Plus.
Okay,
£100 cheaper than the XS.
Right.
And £200 cheaper than the iPhone XS Max. But actually...
So still a premium price.
Still a premium price.
But maybe slightly less damaging to your wallet.
Yeah, and also the contract prices seem a lot more affordable for the P20, the P30 Pro from what I've seen. And you also get a free Sonos One if you pre-order it, so.
Okay.
It's kind of a nice little thing. Huawei always kind of do little incentives to get you to pre-order. But yeah, overall it's a really good phone that has a really good camera and yeah, it's very complete and it's a very credible opposition if you don't want to get a Samsung Galaxy S10.
Yeah, I suppose like Samsung and Apple are kind of in everyone's faces. So there's going to be a new Galaxy, there's going to be a new iPhone every year and they're going to be great. And also, you know, they're going to be expensive, let's be honest. These are premium devices. It feels very much like Huawei is the third position.
Yeah, I mean, in terms of worldwide sales, they are just behind Samsung. So, you know, they're a big brand, even if maybe the person on the street hasn't always heard of them, whereas compared to Samsung. But they're only getting bigger.
I've noticed that they're advertising more on, like, TVs and billboards.
Yeah, they're advertising everywhere. They kind of have lots of celebrity endorsements, and deservedly so with this phone, because it is very, very good, and definitely worth a look. Cool. And the four of you will be on the site when you see this video.
That's right. It's going to be down in the description where you can like, subscribe, and leave a comment if you've enjoyed this video. So we want to wrap this up fairly soon, but I couldn't really do that without talking about these cans I've had dangling from around my neck for the duration of this episode of Tech of the Week. These are the Creative Super X-Fi headphones, and I've spent the morning getting to know these. I have to say, I haven't really been listening to music much on these to be able to give you a full verdict yet, but I can tell you a few things about them. They cost £150.
Okay.
So and not too expensive, about what you might pay for a premium gaming headset. Mm-hmm. They're designed primarily for listening to music, but you could, in a pinch, use this for gaming as well. One of the standout features of the Super X-Fi is this control here will boost a kind of 3D sound.
Right. That sounds like a marketing gimmick. Well, is it?
Well, it does make a fairly dramatic difference to the music that you're listening to. And the sales pitch for these is it's kind of designed to make mono recordings sound like they're stereo. And personally, I'm not a massive music audiophile snob or anything like that. I'm one of those people that couldn't tell you the difference between like a high bitrate MP3 and FLAC. I'm just not, you know, my ear's not that good. However, I have spent some time listening to some mono recordings on YouTube, the Velvet Underground's first album. There's mono and stereo versions of that. You can find that anywhere, so that's a fairly easy thing to, you know, if you want to compare a mono and stereo mix, I think that would be a good thing, a good benchmark to use. So I've been listening to that, and I don't really think that these make a massive difference. Well, not what I would consider to be a positive difference there anyway. It's certainly bassier, certainly bigger, but whether you want that kind of music to sound like you're listening to it in a big concert hall or not is another thing. Like, I don't know how you feel about the Velvet Underground. I don't feel that band necessarily needs to sound like, you know, they're artists.
I don't know if I want my music to be artificially boosted by a pair of headphones.
I think for some things it'd work. I guess it really does depend what you're listening to. I listened to some of the Stephen Wilson remixes of the early Yes albums, and I think Super X-Fi really kind of benefited that.
Okay.
But then again, that is like a fairly modern remix of records that were recorded, you know, about a decade after the Velvet Underground and in, you know, top of the line studios for the day. Yeah. So I think it really depends on the source material. Okay. Generally though, these are really comfortable. And as you can see in here, they've got a big L for left and a big R for right. In case you're confused as to which way you're supposed to be wearing these, you can listen to it via Bluetooth or there's wired options there as well. This works with Creative's mini DAC, which sadly you don't get in the box, which would be a nice little freebie, I guess. But I think the build quality is really quite nice as well. These are really good, and a review of these will be popping up on Trusted Reviews soon. It's not going to be me that's reviewing them, unfortunately. Okay. So I'm just standing in today.
Probably for the best.
Yeah, probably. I mean, I think I've demonstrated in the last couple of minutes. I don't really know what I'm talking about when it comes to audio fidelity, I really like these, and there's another thing about these that is quite cool is that using the app for iOS and Android, when you're setting this up, you can have somebody like it'll the app will take a picture of your ears and a picture of your face, and I don't really know a whole lot about the science behind it. And again, it sounds like a gimmick, but the idea is that it's meant to build up a digital profile of what your ears look like. And so in theory, then the speakers will be right. better able to drive the sound at your eardrums. It'll meant embiggen the sound somehow.
Right.
Again, okay. just as well, I'm not reviewing these, right? But they are okay, very
sounds,
nice.
It sounds an interesting idea.
Yeah, yeah. And I suppose the good thing is once you've created your ear profile and you've stored it on your phone, you could give these to a colleague. They can create a profile for them, and you're not...
You could have ear profiles everywhere.
Absolutely, yeah. And that way, no one's preferences get erased by anybody yeah. else. I think we should end it there,
yes,
don't you?
Yeah. I agree.
Okay, well, if you've made it this far, thanks again for watching. We hope you've enjoyed this installment of Tech of the Week. We will be here every week. And yeah, you know what to do. If you've got any questions or comments, leave them below the line. And thanks once again for watching. See
Thank
you soon.
You.